which is on display at the Rail Giants Museum in California. Let me see here. So this locomotive was donated. Again, back in the 1950s, the Union Pacific donated equipment. They received a request from the Railway and Locomotive Historical Society, at the Southern California chapter. They requested that the Union Pacific give them a big boy, and they did. So throughout the executive channels and the decision making through the supply department, Cheyenne, Wyoming gets a notification, get a big boy ready, it's going to be donated. So they pull the 4014, just happened to be literally the next one in line. In the shop it comes, they put it together, they give it a paint job, and they send it to California. It takes many weeks for it to get there. And here it sits for 52 years. 52 years. At that time, that was longer than I'd been alive. So it showed up in California years before I was born. And they did a remarkable job preserving it. But a big locomotive, any piece of machinery is expensive to maintain, even just sitting there. Keeping it painted, keeping it safe for the public, making it presentable for a museum display. You know, that's a big commitment. And this museum has some really cool locomotives. If you're into steam locomotives, it's called the Rail Giants Museum. It's in the LA Fairplex. So we had an interesting challenge. We were 1 mile away from somebody's railroad, and it wasn't our railroad. So that was the fun part. But again, undaunted, and with the enthusiastic support of the Union Pacific, we went to work and built this track. So this is the first moment that I sat in the cab of the locomotive. I could hardly contain myself. We went through a few different levels of approvals, and when we were deciding to actually restore the locomotive, the first conversation was, are you interested? Would you like to restore a big boy? Again, I'm professional. I don't want to jump up and down. But in all seriousness, you know, there was a very, this reverence of the importance, the significance of the commitment that we're making, and the fact that we're obligating future generations to this massive locomotive. And I made that clear. I wanted them to understand it as part of the decision making. This is a massive locomotive. It's essentially, it is two of our 844s, and this executive was very familiar with the 844 and all of its logistics. I said, it's no exaggeration that the big boy is two 844s. They're smaller driver diameter and a slightly smaller cylinder. Other than that, if you do the math and you measure everything, it's two 844s. So twice the fuel, twice the weld, twice. Okay, that's cool, good. So the next day, the conversation was, I reminded them that the Union Pacific didn't own any more big boys. We donated them all. The last one we really had in ownership was 1975 through 79, the 4023, which is a locomotive of the second series, for those of you that are familiar with that. So he simply looked at me with a smile and said, go get us a big boy. Well, what does that mean? To me, it was George Marshall telling General Patton to go. And so with that level of authority, I immediately knew that the 4014 was the locomotive that I wanted to have. Had a few other things. We were out in the middle of a trip with the 844, so I couldn't rush right out there and do it. I called the Rail Giants Museum, left them a phone message. It took them 2 weeks to get back with me. It was an old-fashioned phone recording. You know what? They still have those 10 years ago. And so when I went out there, I told him, I'm Ed Dickens, Union Pacific. I'd like to talk to you about the 4014 and the 9000. Because I didn't want them to know just yet that we were going to restore the locomotive. So I asked to meet with some decision makers. We met at the front gate. As we were walking to the locomotive, I just couldn't contain myself anymore. We didn't even make it to the front of the locomotive. I said, I'm here to ask you if you would be willing to give us the locomotive back. We're not going to buy it. We're going to lease it for 99 years. We would like it back. We want to run it. Will you negotiate with me? And one of the museum volunteers He figuratively pulled the keys from his pocket and handed them to me. And that member is Paul Gershio. So here we are, months later. We've done a lot of work to the locomotive to get it ready to move. And now I'm going to tell my crew how we're going to move this thing. And I really haven't given them a lot of the details. You know, we've been busy working on it. So this is at a restaurant. I've got a note, and I've got a model of a truck and track and a model of a big boy that one of my friends gave me. And I'm going to walk them through how we're going to move the locomotive. And that's exactly what we did. Again, with the support of Union Pacific behind us. If you can think about all the I's that need dotted and the T's that need crossed, all the municipalities that you're working with, all the utility companies, there was an airport adjacent to that. Just a fascinating project, just all by the numbers. But we literally took 26 track panels and, like a big giant model railroad, moved that locomotive out. Before we could do that, we had to move the other display locomotives, which hadn't moved in years, move them out of the way, and then begin moving the big boy back. And we bend that track, and that's heavy track. It's a lot of physical work, but some of the funnest times that we've ever had. We had to shoehorn that locomotive all over the place to get it moved. Lots of manual labor, 100% Union Pacific labor. So there was some thoughts about hiring somebody, because that's oftentimes a consideration, hire a contract company. Well, who has experience moving big boys the way that I would like it to be moved? We're not going to move it and put it on display somewhere else. We're going to move it to use it. So there's some sensitivities around mechanical things. So I was pretty adamant that we'll do it ourselves. And at the end of the day, that's the best call. And here it is right in the middle of the Los Angeles County Fairgrounds. And it must have been, we were so busy moving it, I took a lot of photos, but not as much as I wish I would have. So I'm thankful for those that did. So moving it across, and you can see the heavy duty plywood that we've got underneath there, but look at how straight that track is. Just really diligent work. And that's intimidating. You know, that big locomotive sitting out there weighs as much empty as the 844 does, ready to go. It's 455 tons sitting there, all on that wood plywood. And there's that big machine that we used, and there's the raceway. So it's just an absolute blast moving it back. And then returning it back to Cheyenne was really fun. Lots of work, but we used two special locomotives on the trip home. We have a fleet of over 1,000 SD70M locomotives. Happens to be my favorite type of locomotive, and that's what that locomotive model there is, the 484. So for those that are familiar with the big boy, that is a 4884 wheel arrangement. Four wheels on the front, first set of drivers on the first engine is 8, second set of 8, and four wheels under the trailing truck. We used the Southern Pacific Heritage engine to pull it out of the museum, but when we came home with it, we used the 4014 SD70M, which we've since renumbered. So here's the last picture there, and we traded them an SD40 locomotive, one of the first SD40s that's been donated to a museum. The SD40 was the backbone and workhorse of America's locomotive network for years. So it was really a privilege to be able to give them. We just didn't give them a carcass. We gave them a locomotive that's fully functional and it actually runs. So here we're going to get into some of the rebuild. And before we could rebuild the 4014, we rebuilt the 844. So our plan originally was to just take 5.5 years and really take our time and make that big boy really nice. We found a few problems on the 844 and we took it apart. This is what we found, and we had to fix it. This is on the inside of the boiler. So water treatment and water chemistry on steam locomotives is critical. In the days when steam locomotives operated, that was one of the main motivations for railroads to accelerate their dieselization, was the poor water conditions and the tremendous resources that were devoted to water service. In different parts of the country, you need to soften the water, add chemical additives. All of that takes time and money, and it's a tremendous effort. An entire department devoted to maintaining the water service for the Union Pacific. Well, this scale had accumulated from 2005 until it just couldn't run anymore in 2012, 2013. We had a few little problems with the engine, and my vision is to correct some of the problems in the boiler. But as we got into it, that's what we discovered. So you can see the tubes, that's the interior part of the boiler, just literally getting to the point where it will no longer be able to contain pressure. So we took that apart and we made it new again. Part of the work that we do is we reverse engineer and we analyze the metallurgy of the steel to determine that it's the proper materials. In the case of the 844, the materials were good. Some of the materials were not that were used on the 3985. You can see that top bolt there, there's like that little line in there. That's an actual hole that goes through that part of that structure. And you can see it's drilled off a little bit. So as we go through, that's kind of the analysis that we do, and we just make all new parts. This is part of the inside of water glass. You can't quite see it. Let me see if I can get that. This is beginning to plug up with scale. And then down in here, this photograph's a little bit blurry, but there's cracking on that part. That part is from the steam era. So there's some nostalgia when you're talking about restoring an old part. Sometimes I think in automobile restorations, you want to keep the left front fender. Say you weld it up, or maybe you bond to it, or you restore it in a way. And there's a sense of pride in restoring that locomotive. When it comes to the safety and the fitness of a steam locomotive, I throw that out the window because it has to contain that pressure. So what we did is we just began gearing ourselves up to make all these big, really fascinating, heavy-duty parts with the correct material. Another example of what was in the 844, the corrosion is a result of the water action, the oxygen in the water, and its action on the steel. So the steam locomotive, when it's operating, there's water chemistry, and the water's hot, and it's going through, and the water chemistry's maintained at a specific standard. The danger is when you're done operating the steam locomotive for the year, you have to prepare it to lay up, meaning that we're not gonna run it for a while. If you don't do that, the water sits in all these little places, and inside of weeks, months, or years, but usually it's pretty short, that corrosive action of the water will destroy all of those beautiful metal parts. So if you can think about it, here's a little science project. So when there's water in steel, the atmospheric oxygen in the air that we're breathing continues to oxygenate and keep that cycle of corrosion going as long as there's moisture in there. So if you lay your locomotive up, preserve it with some type of oil process that displaces the water, or what we do is we dry the locomotive completely out and we heat it. So right now, 24/7, the 4014 and the 844 are sitting in a shop in Cheyenne with electric heaters in them, and they're nice and hot and dry. So we got the 844 all built, rebuilt, we put a new floor in the cab, did tons of work, fixed the boiler, piped it all back up again, and this is what it looked like. Absolute magnificent machine. The neat thing about the 844, it's the very last steam locomotive that the UP bought, the very last one. It was delivered in December of 1944 with a Christmas wreath and a sign from the American Locomotive Company. Merry Christmas, Union Pacific Railroad, from the American Locomotive Company. Thanks for all the years of service. They bought their locomotives exclusively from Alco for many years. Kind of a neat name, isn't it? American Locomotive Company. And those are the big magnificent 80-inch drivers on the 844. We've done a lot of work on those. Now we get into the really exciting part of the big boy.
Some before and after pictures. So after sitting 52 years in the museum in California, we have, this is called a lubricator. It's a hydraulic pump, and it pumps the oil all the various parts of the locomotive that need lubrication. And we actually rebuilt it right then and there. We took it apart and we set ourselves up a nice little work area, and we cleaned it up and serviced the internal components. Some of them were still serviceable, and others were replaced with material that we have on hand. Because when we brought the locomotive home, I remember one of our executives cornered me one day in the headquarters building when we were talking about returning the big boy home. And he said, "You're not bringing that thing home on the rails, are you?" And I said, "Sir, if it can't come home on the rails, it's not worth restoring." And really, realistically, there's no other way you can really return a big boy home. I mean, if you're going to run it, bring it home on its wheels. So that was step one. So we needed those lubricators to work. And this is the front part of the engine. Remember that the big boy is two engines under one boiler. So this is leaves. We've cleaned most of the leaves and the pine needles, but there was literally inches with leaves and pine needles that sat right up on an embankment of trees, and just for decades. And the museum had really been good at cleaning some of that off, but the interior areas where you couldn't were just full. And this is what it looks like when we were getting it all back together again. So much heavy-duty work. People ask, how in the world do you work on something like that? And the answer is that you just have to start. You just got to start working. It's easy to take things apart. That's the easy part. You get in there with a cutting torch or a bunch of wrenches, and you start disassembling the locomotive piece by piece. And if you're not keeping track of things, you got a pile of parts. And some of the parts start to look the same. So very carefully photograph and get into the blueprints. And we're very lucky to have a full set of drawings. So this is the front part of the locomotive that actually starts to articulate, a big giant wear liner. And it hadn't moved for decades. And as soon as we got it into the first curve, we could see all of this. And we just clean it up and get ready to bring it home again. This is what's called an eccentric rod. And that's what it looks like today. And interestingly enough, that bearing is still available. In modern industry, so much of the heavy industrial capacity in industry comes from the railroad in some form or fashion. Now we get into the big heavy-duty parts of the actual rebuild. Look at the size of, this is the front of the locomotive, the area called the smoke box. And there are pictures in many books over the years showing this perspective when you have workers in the front. And these are 6 foot high guys. They're 6 foot tall. They're crouched down and we're getting ready to take out the front part. It's called the superheaters. Another view looking down. Throughout the process, we were so busy, especially as we got toward the end of the project. Our intention was to have the locomotive available for the anniversary, a very key anniversary in the Union Pacific. In 1862, President Lincoln signed the Pacific Railway Act, which effectively created the Union Pacific Railroad. And in 1869, they drove the Golden Spike and Promontory Summit in Utah, uniting a nation. There's only one chance to celebrate the 150th anniversary, and that date's not going to move for the big boy. So we had to get this done. My original plans, and I've come to really enjoy spreadsheets and Gantt charts and figuring out how to do things, but life happens, things happen, supply chain issues, malfunctions, anything's going to happen. And we got behind schedule. My original idea was to have the locomotive done about 2.5 months before the deadline. And we would run it 500 miles, take our time, break it in, test it, take it to Denver, kind of quietly behind the scenes. I don't know how you quietly take a big boy anywhere. That was the vision. So we needed to be in Ogden on May 9th. On May 2nd, it moved under its own power. And that later that night, we took it on a break-in run, and I wanted to get at least 100 miles, and I settled for 70. We had a little problem. One of the components was running warm, kind of a technical issue that we could resolve, and we resolved it by actually backing up. So we got the locomotive back to Cheyenne, and on May 4th, just less than 48 hours after we got back to Cheyenne, we departed. We had our CEO and his wife break a bottle of champagne over the front of the locomotive, and we set out to celebrate the 150th anniversary of the Union Pacific. And this is how we did it. Very careful, diligent, meticulous, putting that locomotive back together again. As I said, it's easy to take things apart. But when you put it back together again, the secret to this is, I'm going to share a secret with you. Don't waste time on the old parts. The old parts have served their time. They've served well. Put them in a museum. Make new parts. When you're working on old equipment, it's really easy to get bogged down in that nostalgia. And you think in your mind, well, if we just weld these components up over here, we have these guys welding it up, and then they'll go grind it down again, or maybe we'll machine it. Well, by the time you figure all of that time, energy, and effort, and the resulting quality of the product, you are easily money ahead, time ahead, and effort to just design the new parts, which is what I've always wanted to do. I've worked around lots of locomotives, smaller locomotives, of course, on the Durango and Silverton and a few other railroads in Colorado. And I always wanted to see some of those parts that were old, in some cases nearly 100 years old. And they're really loose, for example. And you want to just make a new part. So this was my opportunity. So we've got all the springs, and think about the suspension system on a big boy. You know what that means. There's coil springs, giant leaf springs. What a leaf spring is this horizontal piece right here. In its plates of a specific alloy of steel, heat treated and bound together with what's called a buckle right here, specially made. And the company that makes those doesn't make them anymore. But luckily, I was able to convince them. And that was part of my job. That was one of the more important parts of what I needed to do, was go find the vendors and suppliers and talk them into making some oddball parts. Some capacity, some industry is set up to make stuff, and it's just nothing for them to go into production and making your stuff. Other times, it's just too oddball, and we don't need thousands of them, so they're not that interested in making 20 or 4 or whatever the case may be. So out comes the big boy salesmanship hat with a pocket full of pins and just the enthusiasm that comes with being a part of this. And people tell me all the time, oh, you're so enthusiastic. And I used to be a little embarrassed by that because, you know, it's your professional, it's your job. But how can you not be? This is a once in a lifetime opportunity to restore this piece of equipment. And there we are getting the front engine. So this represents the Union Pacific 844 without the rear four wheels. And that's no exaggeration whatsoever. The front part of that big boy. And when you start seeing it come together in the shop, and I was up on a man lift to get these pictures. I mean, when's the next time you're going to be able to take a picture like this? But you just... We would remark to each other, you know, we'd comment, wow, look at how big this thing is. And, you know, it's lost on you when it's disassembled because all the individual parts are scattered all over the place. But once you start putting it together again, we start, wow, this thing is huge. More new parts and more drivers. So the big drivers, that's what these are. And that's what we call the axle assembly and the two wheels. We had all of those positioned out on the floor, just almost ran out of floor space. We formed some boilerplate to actually replace part of the boiler. So we get creative, and we weld all of these different stacks of metal together that represent that shape of that part of the boiler, and then fasten it, weld it to replace the piece that wasn't effective. But you could tell when we took apart the inside, you could see the backside of it, and we're like, oh, we should replace that. So as you get into the project, as you take it apart, you find that you still got some disassembly ahead of you. You look forward to the day when you stop taking it apart. And this is how we get those big wheels out of it. And again, you can see all the fascinating parts of that suspension system, brand new coil springs, that big component we just saw in a few slides ahead. The funnest part is to completely sandblast everything. So you take it completely apart, you strip all the nuts and bolts, all the lubrication lines, and it looks like some of the photographs that you see in the books where they're building these locomotives in Schenectady, New York. Anybody know what a locomotive encyclopedia is? I've got several of them, and as the name implies, it literally is an encyclopedia that details steam locomotive parts. Well, in that book, there are pages that show the big boys being built. And when they built those, the frames were built in general steel castings in Granite City, Illinois. And they had those castings, once they come out of the mold and they clean them up, and they would paint them with a special coat of paint that would show the highlights. That's exactly what they looked like when we were done sandblasting those. Here's that piece where we have the little patch. You can't quite see it really well, but that's where that patch goes. All of the bumps that you see on here, most of them, some of them are rivets, but most of those are those stay bolts that I mentioned. And that's what actually holds the inside of the firebox together. And that's where the fuel is burned. And on the big boy, we replaced 800 stay bolts. And there's over 4,000 in there. On the 844, when we did that work, we replaced 435. So that's a lot of work. Numbers that you keep track of. An interesting picture because it shows that big giant spring and those huge, big heavy-duty pipes. So you have just a quick moment to snap these neat pictures. More new parts that we're making. This is part of the valve gear that controls the mechanism that controls the admission of the steam in the cylinder. And we made those all new as well. That was some of the fun part of being able to talk to my executive bosses and explain to them what we will have when we were done. When we are done with this, we will have a locomotive that will be ready for decades of service. One more shot of the front engine. Lots of memories flood back whenever I look at these pictures. This big piece right here is the exhaust from the cylinders. So as a steam engine operates, there's your valves. Here's the cylinder. The cylinder is 24 inches, so it's the size of a 55-gallon drum. That steam in the cylinder pushes against the piston, which is connected to the main rod and the connecting rod. It's kind of like the bicycle, if you can envision that. On a big boy locomotive, the pressure of the steam is 300 psi, and it's superheated, so the temperature is 750 degrees. I mean, think about that. When we operate this locomotive, it doesn't look like this anymore. This bronze is somewhat tarnished because of the 700 degree heat. This entire surface of the locomotive is over 600 degrees. So when we come up a long hill, when we came through Beaumont, when we stopped at Orange, as we were traveling, when that big boy went by, how many people felt the heat radiating off of that? Perfectly normal. We came into Cheyenne, we had the mayor of Cheyenne with us, and we were working up about a 20-mile grade, and we were running pretty fast. And we pulled into Cheyenne, and that front engine smoked for 30 minutes. You couldn't get more than 2 feet from it. Completely normal. It's actually caught fire a few times. You're going down the track, and there might be some leaves or some debris that will find their way up in this area. And next thing you know, and we just say, oh, we got flames. 1940s. Some pictures of the inside of the springs. You know, just really fascinating, hardcore work. All new equipment. And that's what it looks like when you're underneath. We had to do some other work. So we've got the wheel, and we drop down this component in our shop called a drop table, and it looks like a model train, doesn't it? How many people have a Lionel train or an HO N-scale train? Well, this is the real thing right here. This particular wheel, anybody want to guess what that wheel weighs? It's about 16,000 pounds, that one. The main is 20,000 pounds, this one, 10 tons. So just that one wheel is 10 tons. Another really big, cool part that we made, this is a part of the suspension system that attaches to the front four wheels. And you can't get a sense of scale, but these pins and all of the that's called an equalizer, are huge. So if the equalizer were sitting here, it would span from here to the wall. And it would crush the wood, of course. But the steam locomotives are just absolutely massive. The area that pin fits up into is part of the frame that we've machined, and we've installed a new bushing. So just the process of putting that locomotive together, that's the secret when you put it together with new parts. I'll share another little secret with you. So there was some doubt in some social media corners of the train fan world that A, we're going to get this thing done. And it looks like they're not going to get it done. So as we would release photographs and talk about it, I might have indicated that maybe we weren't as far along as we were. By accident, maybe. But I knew we were going to get it together. I might have showed him a video from 2 weeks ago, or a few pictures from whenever. But this is the front four wheels. Again, new wheels, new springs. And you can't see it because we've got it all covered with nice lubrication. But it's that big giant pin, and we're getting ready to lower this front engine down. And remember, it's as big as the 844. We've got it suspended with our 40-ton crane holding the back of it, two 50-ton cranes on each side on the front of it, and we have the entire front engine this high. The bottom of it is this high. And we're gradually going to lower it down and put first four wheels on it. Now the fun begins to actually start putting the cab together. You've got the locomotive. Now remember, it took us 2.5 years. So about a year and a half or so, there was nothing on the boiler. It was just a bare boiler. And we're starting to put everything back together. This is how we get the drawbar pin out. That's what connects the engine and tender together. And I like to tell this story because of my time in the Air Force. I got to see Air Force One from afar one time. And I was so impressed. That's the aircraft that our chief executive, our president, flies aboard. And the Air Force has the honor to man that aircraft, you know, with men and women in the air crew. And on the underside of the wings, blue, beautiful presidential blue, it says USAF. It's an Air Force plane, but it's outfitted for our president. Well, in my view, the 844 represents that same level of reverence. So I like the way I like to talk about the 844, it's the Union Pacific's Air Force One. Well, if the 844 is Air Force One, do we have any Marines in here? The 4014 is Marine One. So it has the same distinction as that beautiful helicopter. So on the floor, we have a stainless steel welded together number plate. And this picture doesn't give it justice, but if I had it here, it would be this tall. And it's welded together stainless steel with Union Pacific 4014. When you climb up in the cab, you're impressed with the locomotive. If you happen to be standing there, let's say you're going to go along for a ride, and you've been invited to ride a little bit in the 844. It's a rare opportunity, but it happens. So you watch the 4014 come in, the front engine comes by at 600 degrees, it's loud, the whistle's blaring. You're just impressed with this machine. On the outside of it, you see the beautiful paint you see the ladder, all the old 1940s air brakes, all perfectly rebuilt. And you climb into the cab, and as you look down, you actually stand on that beautiful number plate. So that's the reverence of our Marine One. We keep it clean every day. A steam locomotive is a rugged machine. It's like an industrial rock crusher. I mean, when you work on steam locomotives, you'd swear they're trying to disassemble themselves. They're trying to self-destruct. You know, if you could see an automobile engine, let's just say that we had a transparent firewall in your car and your crankcase was transparent and you could see the engine working, you know, what it would look like. That's a steam locomotive, but on a very industrial scale. Some more air brake parts, as I mentioned there. That's a really fun part of the project, is making the locomotive compatible with the network. We have a safety control system called Positive Train Control, and it's a very advanced system of electronics that's tied into our wayside signals, cell towers, GPS receivers, and it's a very intricate safety system that's on board every one of our locomotives, including the 4014. But how do you tie in all of that gear and all of that tech and make it compatible, make it work with the 1940s technology? And it's actually rather simple. You know, I've become somewhat of an air brake geek. As part of some of my early apprenticeships, I wanted to be a locomotive engineer. And I knew the key to really running a train successfully was to get to know those air brake books. And some of my mentors over the years, I have a vast library of train books, and a lot of them are these neat old air brake books. So that's one of our proud achievements, that we have PTC installed on the locomotive. All the electrical gear, you won't see a lot of fancy gadgets. I don't believe in gadgets. If it's not needed, we don't need it in the cab of the locomotive. We have the necessary PTC computer systems. We have a 12-volt vehicle radio that we have in the automobiles. And then we have other safety systems. Other than that, this is all the same conduit from the 1940s. So that's another proud accomplishment. You won't see a lot of gadgetry in there. All right, we're just about to the point where we're going to, I'm going to show a few videos of some exciting trips that we've taken. If you can think about all the video content that exists out there, it's really hard to pick out videos because there's so much of it available. I don't get to see the locomotive. I haven't been out of the cab when it's moving. So this is going up Cajon Pass. And there's the big boy way up front. This is one of the last cars on the train. So that locomotive is working pretty darn hard. And the diesels are in power as well. We've got an engineer and a fireman. There's two of us. And we also have what we call a pilot crew. So we're not, technically we're not qualified on the division that we're operating on, so we'll have an engineer and a conductor in the cab with us, or one or the other. So we're making about 28 miles an hour. Over the years, people send me video of guests that ride in the cab, and they'll share some of the video that they've taken. This is a shot of the firebox. One of the frequent questions we get is, what fuel does it burn? And it burns used motor oil. It's a very crude, simple process of burning that fuel. Again, think about 1940s. Steam locomotives, simple. Keep it simple. The more complexity you have, the more mechanisms, the more gadgets, you know, the more that you have the likelihood of having some failure. So the oil actually flows out literally like it's called a drooling burner, and it literally just gurgles out. And there's a slot where the steam atomizes it and breaks it up, and makes a little rooster tail flame in the firebox. This is the, once again, the donation special rolling through. You'll be able to see the side rods and everything on the 3985 and the 5511. Going to its new home for future restoration. And the 5511. And I rode that the entire trip, you know, just to monitor things. We were having a few little problems with some technical things. So it's just better to monitor and ride it so you can make sure that there's no problems. We also donated various passenger equipment, a caboose. This locomotive you see back here was donated to the Boone and Scenic Valley. That's a Chicago Northwestern F7. And that's one of our modern diesel engines in the back. And we've got lots of spare parts that we were taking to our counterpart shop in Council Bluffs, Iowa. And the freight equipment is just what we call idler cars. So they're there to satisfy regulatory braking requirements. It's a little bit of a funny story. One of my colleagues called me the morning we left Cheyenne. He said, "Hey, Ed, there's a steam engine out running in the Sydney sub. Are you on it?" I said, "Yes." He goes, "Hey, you're running 25 miles an hour. Any way you could run 40? Because that's one of the sensitivities, is that we don't want to impact our network velocity. And what that means is that the ability for our trains to move, to meet the requirements of our customers. And when we're traveling with the older equipment, in this instance, we just had to run slower. Not everybody gets the message that, oh, we're running this train and it's slow. And he happened to not get it. So I said, "I'm going to send you a picture and you'll understand what we're doing." So we're stopping there and we're getting ready to service the equipment. I think we have a few more, and then we've got just a few moments. We can have some questions and answers, I think. Okay. Yes. His question was, he noticed that there was some steel, some bronze, and some copper. And I think I know what you were referring to. And that's part of what we call our centering device. And the bronze is simply a sleeve, if you will, that allows the steel to glide within. So you got the dissimilar metals plus the lubrication that allows it to function. Here's a neat video. So this is Fort Hancock. East of El Paso, if I remember right. That's Austin Barker in the cab firing the locomotive. So I am very, very fortunate, very blessed to have such to work with such great people. Ted Schulte, he's now retired, but he was my right-hand man for many years, a locomotive engineer and fireman. Kurt Clark, he's my second engineer. Just an absolute, and this is for everyone, but I'm going to repeat it because they're such fine people and such great craftsmen. But Kurt, he's 6'6", 240, maybe 260. He always reminds me of that song, Big John. And if he were here, he'd be blushing right now, but he breaks tools. He doesn't mean to. He's just a big person. And when we burn up an electric drill, we call it letting the smoke out. You know, and you can always tell, "Kurt, did you burn that drill up?" And we've got Jimmy Thompson, Boilermaker. Jimmy is training to be a fireman, an absolute fabulous skilled welder. And he is well on his way to working his way into just more supervisory responsibilities. There's a lot of responsibility on the UP, on the steam program. Here's a rotary snowplow that we deployed in March. That's something you don't see every day. That was made in 1971 in the Omaha shops, and it's kept in Cheyenne, and it's part of our responsibility. A lot of people don't really know that it's there because it's not used. It's like a spare tire in your car. It's like a fire extinguisher in the room here. You know, you hope you don't need it, but if you do, you better hope that it works. Well, the rotary snowplow is just that. Here's a neat video of us flying by, working our way toward through Alpine, and we're coming into San Antonio. And carry on with my introduction. We've got John Stravino, our newest member of our team. He's the latest Boilermaker, another very talented, very passionate individual, again, working his way through our apprenticeships, learning the locomotives. It literally takes years. When you consider how often we operate the locomotives, you know, it's not like we're running them weekly, monthly. You know, we may operate them only a month, maybe 2 months out of the year. So we don't have an opportunity for that hands-on, on-the-job training. So we really want to compress all of those opportunities when we're out in the field and really get the most out of that. So when we're not operating the locomotive, there's a lot of time I'll spend with them, sharing the library that I have, working with them, teaching them things, and encouraging them. That's the funnest part of a job, is encouraging people. When you realize that you have the power as the boss or power of somebody and in a position of authority, oftentimes we just see ourselves as who we are. I'm just Ed. But in their eyes, the words that you say, the advice that you have, the encouragement that you have is really impactful. You think back, I think back over those moments in my life when people had mentored me. At the time, I didn't really necessarily see it. I'm very fortunate, having served in the military, I learned to keep my mouth shut. And that's, and I mean that in a very serious way, that oftentimes when you're asked about something, you want to tell everybody how much you know. And when someone is telling you something, if your mouth is open, your ears aren't. And so I'm very fortunate that, and I'm sure as a young person, I knew it all. I can think back when I started on the railroad. But I'm very thankful that I had the mentors that I did. And they cared for us, they cared for me, and they helped me. And so now I'm in a position so I can handpick this crew and encourage them along to do this great work. You know, and it's something that anybody can do. Yes. Her question was what the budget was for that, for our project. And we get this a lot, and I try not to be too humorous about it, but we're adequately funded, but it's not as much as you think, but it's, if you think about all of the work that we did, I've got some hands going up back there. All of the work that we did, we really made very good use of the resources. And it's not as much as you think. We got some questions from the other room? Oh, very good. I got you. I keep moving around. There we go. Oh, good. Oh, very good. Okay. All right. Did I answer your question? Did I sound kind of evasive? Only because it's a fabulous project, and it's such a privilege and an honor, and you know, to have the responsibility to do that work. And I say this, and I mean, I've got this respect just beaming from me, is that when you're doing a project like that, it's important for people to stay out of your way. And that means that the responsibility is yours, and they entrust you with it. That means there's accountabilities along the way, but at the end of the day, they're trusting you to get the work done. Well, we've got this question. Yes.
I grew up in Old Town, Beaumont, on Fifth Street, which is very close to First Street. And the other side of First Street were the railroad tracks.
Oh, thank you. And my brother and I used to love to go down to the tracks, and as the trains went by, we would wave at the engineers, and the engineers would always wave back at us. Thank you.
Thank you. That's a very special part of the job. So the Big Boy is such a popular locomotive, and those of us that are on the locomotive and around it, you know, we become recognizable because of our positions with the locomotive. And that bears responsibility with young children and people that it's so heartwarming and many times moved to emotion when you see the reaction of people. And just telling you, I start to get a little emotional, but let me share one quick story. So we came into this town, and this has happened many times with this locomotive. I'll try not to crackle in my voice, but I can feel it coming. So we're in town, we're coming into town, and I'll set the stage for you. So here comes the Big Boy. The Union Pacific has announced that we're running the Big Boy. And we've published the schedule, and here we come. And the person who's running the locomotive has a watch on my wrist, and I'm running it to the minute, to the extent that I can. Our railroad is giving us the authority to operate this locomotive and lighting up the signals, giving us a clear way. And oftentimes, I would say, 90% or better, we are to the minute on time. So with that in mind, here we are, look at your watch, and you hear this whistle in the distance. And the whistle is magnificent. You can hear it coming. And it was designed to have that loud voice. It's a warning device, a signaling device. So here it comes, we're coming, and you can hear it. And the minutes are ticking down to our arrival time. And we're coming into town, and there is just a sea of people, like a rock concert, all there to see the Union Pacific steam locomotive, the Big Boy. We roll into town, and there's people everywhere. The bottom where my feet are is 11 feet in the air. So my armrest is, I'm up there really high, and you get a really good view of the crowd. And over in the crowd, these people are waving, as they often do. But they keep waving, and they're calling my name. And so, you know, there's things I need to attend to. The locomotive literally is so hot, and it's so powerful and so dangerous, you don't move from the seat. And the guys go up there, they all give me their ID tags, we hang them on our blue flag. It's a special safety procedure that all railroads follow. We have a few little extra steps to it on the steam locomotive, so I'm not gonna go anywhere for a while, and they keep hearing my name. So I kind of figure out, and I kind of nod. A few moments go by, I'm able to finally get down in the cab, I walk over, and there's a, it's the neatest thing. So there's a lady, a grandma, and all she can think about is her dad, you know, her father. And me, just little old me. I'm dressed like a locomotive engineer. I smell like a locomotive engineer. In a good way, with the oil and the grease. My hair is somewhat disheveled. There's grease splattered all over the side of your body. And she can't walk. She's on oxygen. And the family, they're emotional too. And I don't know these people. But she gets up and she just lunges at me and she hugs me. And she starts crying. You know, and you can't help but be moved. And then she pulls out her family, her relatives, pull out a picture of her father. Locomotive engineer, you know, from way back. And that's the connection that is made with people, you know, and she's trembling and she's literally just squeezing me and you know, it's really neat. And I can't tell you the times that kind of stuff happened. Excuse me. Yeah. Little kids, you know, they make these really cool drawings, you know, these sweet little kids. And they look at that locomotive and they see us, you know, and that's the neat part, that they see these people, this heroic project, you know, it's just darn cool. You know, the best time that you could have in a job. Yes.
I can't keep up. I said, run, go. So finally y'all came in and y'all stopped and had it all roped off and everything. And y'all did all y'all safety stuff, and you can see you up in the cab and all that stuff. And everybody came down, and one of the engineers gave him a pin. Mm-hmm. And he told him to keep it forever. And so he brought it home and he said, I've got to keep it. So he has it all with his other stuff in his drawer. And I was wondering if you could sign it for him.
Oh, absolutely. From Kendall Gordon. Are you Kendall? Hi, Kendall. I'd be happy to sign that for you. I'm going to answer some questions. I'll come right over and I'll do that.
Thank you.
You want to help me answer some questions? Come on up. This is Kendall. And you were, where did you see the big boy?
Gateway at Interstate 10.
Okay. What did you think of it?
I like it.
Were you scared?
No.
You weren't scared. That's good. When I was your age, my dad took us to see the 844, and I was scared. I don't know what it is about dads. They want you to be really close. Well, we're going to read this question here. So we have a question from our friends in the other room. How many people were on the crew during the teardown? So there were 11 of us. We have a crew of 6 now, but there was 11 of us that did the teardown. And the last many months, I lived in the shop. You know, we were behind schedule, and the bosses got to be there to get the job done. And my right hand, Austin, he was there the last, I think, month and a half. And the last 6 weeks, I never even went outside. I remember I went out finally when we got the engine running, and there was a layer of dust on my car. But that was a commitment that we had to get the project done. Next one, do you want to read that one?
That one right there.
What top speed on a big boy?
Very good. So what's the top speed of the big boy? That is a very frequently asked question. Anybody want to take a guess at that?
40.
40, okay. Any other guesses?
70.
70 is a good number. 80 is a good number. 80, if you look on Wikipedia, we should get that changed. 80 is the number on Wikipedia. That's not true. The big boys, even though they have a 68-inch driver, the Challengers have a 69-inch driver. The 844 has an 80-inch driver. The big boys were roughly a 60-mile-an-hour locomotive, 55. I've actually run it at 60. Runs just fine. A tremendous balancing act, literally. It loves 45, and we oftentimes run at 40 to 45. It's somewhat counterproductive to have a public relations machine that flies by really quick. So we try to balance that. We try to balance that with, we need to get out of the way of the network, and we want to get where we're going, but 45 is it. So the top speed on the big boy officially is 60. I need to find the documents on the Union Pacific. They had them oftentimes, I've heard. I haven't found the documents, but roughly 55. And the reason for that is because they're so big. That extra driver makes a big difference. Okay, what is the, of the fuel tank? I think I can't quite read that word. Oh, I'm sorry, what is the capacity of the fuel tank? The fuel tank is 6,200 gallons. 6,200 gallons. And how much water does it hold? So the primary tender is 25,000 gallons. And we have two other tenders. And we have two other tenders there. And they the range on those tenders, it's my alarm telling me that I need to be quiet. So with that, our maximum range, our capacity is around 250 miles. Okay, next question here. What would it take to restore a second big boy, and would you change anything from the first? Well, that's a great question. And you know, it's interesting in the world of social media, you know, the I don't know if they start out as a fun rumor or just how things start on social media. Well, what it would take to restore a second one would be everything that we've done on this one. And could we do it? Absolutely. Please don't quote me. We're not going to restore another big boy. And would you change anything from the first? Probably not. It's a very, very good design. Very good design. Okay. All right. If a steam locomotive has unusually fast flange wear, what can cause this and how might you fix it? So what they're asking is the flanges are the part of the wheel on the inside that rides on the rail that keeps rail vehicles on the rail. In this instance, it'd be an alignment issue, not unlike something on your car. So when you're driving your car and you take to get a new set of tires on it, they generally check the alignment. That's the same thing. So you just need to fix the alignment and the maintenance. And here's a question that we get all the time. Does the diesel locomotive attached to the 4014 assist the big boy? What percent of the load is pulled by the 4014? Very good question. So the diesel serves several purposes. Primarily, it's the home for our computer system about that PTC system, the positive train control that I mentioned. We're effectively tethering the big boy to the PTC gear. Moving forward, the PTC gear will be 100% on the 4014. The other reason for that is for what we call dynamic braking. So not unlike a truck where you have a Jake brake. Anybody drive through town and it says engine braking prohibited? That's what that means. Don't use your Jake brake. You can hear those things. You like my sound effects? Well, on a diesel, the dynamic braking is a system that allows the electric motors to become generators, and the electrical gear is configured to take the electrical current that is generated from those motors and dissipate it as heat. And in the generation of that electrical current creates a very significant retarding force, which is braking. And that's one of one of the many benefits to diesel locomotives is that they have that dynamic braking. So it's a very strong braking effort. So if we have the diesel with us, we don't need to use the air brake. So we're going to conserve our resources on the passenger cars because the steam locomotive is special, unique, custom parts, special brakes, expensive, consumable. So if we can offset that by having the opportunity to utilize the modern diesel, then that's a great business decision. So the last part of the question, what percentage of the work of the load is pulled by the 4014? 100%. There are a few times when we're using the diesel for one purpose or another. But 99% of the time, when you see that train flying along, that diesel is 200 tons of more weight. That's it. And if you listen carefully, it might even be dead because it has a special safety feature to save fuel. It shuts itself down. If it's not being used, it goes to sleep. And when you go to use it again, it kind of wakes up, literally. So the big boy's doing all the work. I know that from a visual perspective, I think people, and I know I'm a little bit of a purist. I like to see the steam engine by itself, but there's a really significant business purpose behind that. Do you have any questions you want to ask? Well, thank you for helping me. What grade are you in? Are you a straight A student? Oh, I knew it. Excellent. Excellent. What's your favorite subject? These people are clapping for you. Yes.
Math.
Excellent. Straight A's. Well, I was a straight A's as long as it had something to do with trains. Yeah. Well, do we have any more questions, anyone? There's a couple back here. Yes, sir. I think I missed the first part. Was it if we weren't able to? I really didn't have a plan B because our, and I mean that in all seriousness, it's just the nature of what we need to do. But you could heavy haul it. They've heavy hauled big equipment all the time. The 4023, the other locomotive I mentioned earlier, that was moved by heavy haul. So it's all doable. It's just the logistics and the expense is very, very complicated. And you've got a locomotive that, as I said, is 1940 state of the art. Yeah, it's been sitting there for five decades, but with a little bit of TLC cleanup and the labor of installing the track, you know, we got the job done. Okay, I saw another hand. Yes, sir?
What about pushing that stalled freight?
Pushing the stalled freight. That was a really neat opportunity. And I had my executive vice president in the cab with me. We had just picked up him and his guests, and the dispatcher called me up. So here's the radio conversation. Dispatcher 14, UP 4014. And I pick up the radio. 4014, come in. Hey, can you knuckle into a train? And that's not really the terminology that we use, but I knew exactly what he meant. Because when you look at the steam locomotive, the front coupler is hidden. It swings around. The steam locomotives were designed really to go in one direction. And the later locomotives, they would have the coupler so it literally swiveled out of the way. So if you hit an obstruction, heaven forbid, you're not going to impale it on the coupler. And that was a safety design. And so we swing that coupler around and it doesn't look like it's got a coupler on the front of it. And you'd be surprised if you don't know, you just think, oh, the steam locomotive, well, how in the world, they don't have a coupler. See how it's smooth up there? So I very enthusiastically, but with a high degree of professionalism, said, yeah, we can do that. And then so, you know, you're thinking, oh, this is going to be a fun opportunity. So I waited, didn't hear anything back. I called him up, wanted to know how heavy the train was and what the deal was. And so he gave me a little bit of information, and they really didn't have an opportunity for another alternative. So we're either going to have to wait while we sit in a siding somewhere while they find another locomotive, possibly the one I've got with me. Well, why not just use the steam engine? So that's exactly the decision that, respectfully, that I get to make, that we're going to push this thing. And it wasn't until we started to get ready that I'm thinking, I hope we can do this. Because this is a giant train. I mean, you look at the big boy and the lore of the big boy, it's this unlimited power source. It can do anything. It's like Superman of the rails. And that's not true. It's a locomotive. It's a machine. It's a mechanism. They were rated for 4,000 tons from Ogden to Green River. Well, in our world today, 4,000 tons isn't much. This train was 11,000 tons. And it had two locomotives in the front, and one of them was dead. D-E-A-D. It was gone. There was no resurrecting it. Well, they probably would have been able to make it up the hill, but there was a speed restriction, and they had to slow down for that. And then when they got up, that engine conked out on them. So here's the steam engine behind them. So we got up behind them, and we did all the things that you do. We literally coupled into it. Disengaged, cut out the air brakes. I disengaged my PTC system, went through all the steps, lickety split, coupled into it. Okay, let's go. In my early part of my railroad career, I did that every day, all day for years. We called that manned helpers. Now we have remote control locomotives that are controlled remotely, very advanced technology, but back in the 90s, we didn't have that technology, so I knew exactly what to do. It was just like the old days. And we got up against that train, and that big boy pushed the train up over the hill with my executive vice president sitting right behind me and sitting in the cab and others. And, you know, it's just one of those things that happened, and it's amazing the drone footage and the YouTube footage. I mean, people must have just hightailed it to that location because there's some really neat videos on YouTube. So that was a fun day. Yes, sir. His question was, how easy or how was it to tram up? And what that means is to align the axles within the frame. And that's a fundamental math issue and machining operation. So you take all of the mechanisms the devices that allow the wheel assembly, what we call the driving boxes and the shoes and wedges, and machine those very precisely within the location, and that's called a frame pedestal. And so it's just like your car. When you square up your car, they use lasers and all kinds of fancy technology when you take your car in to get it aligned. The steam locomotive is the same way. We have an instrument called a ferroarm, which is a computerized device that is very accurate over a very large distance. And so we're literally taking and extrapolating all these dimensions, and then it draws a model on the computer for us, and then we can cross-reference and double-check. And we also take and make old-fashioned instruments called a trammel point and a big steel scale. And so we do both. I like the empirical method. So to answer your question, it wasn't that complicated. Same thing on where the engine is connected. All of those relationships have to be just dead on, and you're just checking all that out. So remember I talked about having the frame where we're sandblasted and sitting all by itself? Well, there's little areas, little reference points and machine marks and witness marks when they first built that thing, and they line those part points up. And it's from those points that they take and begin referencing all the other critical dimensions on it. So we discover those, and sometimes you'll see that they move them. Well, now you got to figure out, well, which one is the right one? And that's where you have to go and do your research. A fun homework project. You like homework? Oh, that's a good answer. Mom, proud. And he didn't even hesitate. Well, that's great. What do you want to do when you grow up?
A broadcaster.
Broadcaster, that's excellent. Like a sports broadcaster? That's really good. So this morning, I was able, they invited us to go down, and we were interviewed at the news station. And it was really fun, Channel 12, and it was really fun watching them. You might be able to get a field trip down there, Mom. Yeah, there's a lot of work. Well, to be a broadcaster, so got to clean your room. Why do we got to clean our room? What does that have to do with broadcasting? You just like any job, you got to kind of follow the orders and instruction. If you keep your room clean and you take care of your stuff, the next step in life, it's going to be easier for you. And you get those good grades. And the more you progress, the easier it is for you to study, to do your homework, to don't go home and play. You got to do homework first. And you always got to think about, I want to be a broadcaster. So that means you got to be straight A's. Then you go to school to be a broadcaster. And then you keep getting straight A's. And then once you get your college degree, well, then you get an undergraduate. Well, that means you get a master's degree. And then you might even be able to get a PhD. That's a lot of really good stuff. But the only thing, remember I was saying, the only thing that limits us is things in our own head. So you can do anything you want. We're looking at our sports broadcaster right here. What's your favorite sports? Football? Do you like to play football? I do too. It's been a long time ago. Well, I think we have just a few more minutes for a couple more questions. Are we doing okay, Bill?
Yes, one or two more questions. I think there's one right here.
Okay. What was the locomotive made for, freight or passenger? Well, it was a dual service locomotive, meaning that it could pull a passenger train. But the big boys were too much locomotive for a passenger train. I'm sure they pulled passenger trains somewhere along the line. I'm sure there's pictures of them. They had steam heat for the passenger trains. They were equipped in case they needed it. Remember during the war, that was some of the critical freight and critical passenger movements were the troop trains. But they were just too much locomotive. The Challengers were really well suited for passenger trains. Because a big boy with that 4,000-ton capacity, just like today, we are very judicious when we assign power to trains. You know, we don't have extra locomotives on there just for the sake of having them, unless there's a business purpose to have them. Our premium trains have a lot of locomotives so they can run fast and maintain those schedules that the customers want. Same thing with the steam locomotive. they weren't going to take this big boy, a 4,000 locomotive, and put it on a passenger train, because they've got part of that big boy isn't being utilized. Same as today. That's the neat thing about my job, is that I can see everything that we're doing in our world today, the same that we used to do back then. It's just we're using this really fascinating technology. Did that answer your question for you? All right, we got one more. Make it a good one. Make it a hard one. Yes. How much fun do we have with the big boy? That's a very good question. Let me explain it like this. So there's a lot of work, lots of behind the scenes toil for all of us. The way that the processes that we have, that I have for the steam locomotive, they're very regimented, very disciplined. Everything is exactly step by step. And sometimes you can lose how fun it really is. But there are times when we get out, all the work's done, and we're out in the middle of the prairie or maybe in the mountains or somewhere, and we look at each other and say, this is fun. But it's lost on you sometimes, but it is fun. Blowing the whistle is fun. There's a discipline with that. The whistle's not a toy. It's a signaling device. And every sound that it makes has a purpose and has a meaning. And when we blow the whistle, we're blowing it hundreds of times a day, and this arm gets pretty strong, but it's for a very specific purpose. So why not make it sound neat? So you get to kind of alter the sound a little bit. And each engineer has his own sound and the way he blows it. But that's one of the fun things, because people, and you look out in the crowd of people and they're all doing this, even while you're blowing it. But it's one of the fun things that we do as the caretakers of the Union Pacific asset known as the big boy, to where we can set it up and let people enjoy it. Their structure, their safety, protocols, procedures, and tremendous amounts of work with my colleagues. Richard can attest to that. But once you get all that established, people want to hear the whistle blow. They want to walk up and touch it. One more 30-second story. We had the 844 in Coolidge, Arizona, and we had just operated out of the Phoenix area, and we had to operate backwards because we couldn't turn it around going into Phoenix. So we needed to take water because we had to go from there all the way to Yuma, Arizona. That was a big, long day. I don't know why I planned it like that, but I was pretty new in my role. So we disconnected the locomotive from the train, and we were tying in with the fire hydrant, with the fire department. And we just let everybody walk up. You know, again, it's orderly, it's safe, structured. And here's the Union Pacific rolls into town with their big, magnificent 450-ton 844 Air Force One, beautifully polished, painted, lovely locomotive. And there was an individual, an attorney, who walked up and engaged us. I don't remember meeting him, but he wrote a letter to our chief executive weeks later, commending him on such a magnificent opportunity. Couldn't believe that this railroad's got this locomotive. They just let us walk up to it. And everybody was so friendly. And he goes, I couldn't believe it. That's the fun part of being able to show what these locomotives do. And the big boy has taken that to a whole new level. So with that, I think we're about wrapped up, Belle. Well, thank you, everybody. Thank you, everyone in the anteroom over there. And thank you, Mr. Straight A student.
We were trying to think, what on earth could we give Ed? And thanks for coming tonight. So a trip was made to TKC Knives in Spurger, Texas, and a Union Pacific pocket knife. Allegedly, only 500 of these were made, and we hope you don't have six of them. But at any rate, We appreciate so much your being with us tonight.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody, for coming out, and we'll see you next month.